I'll tell you the secret of getting revival in the church. Find half a dozen people that know how to grow. You won't have the same church in a year. But you can't learn groaning except by the Holy Ghost. It's the school of the Holy Spirit. And if you think that's unusual, look at verse 26, in which he says, likewise the Spirit helpeth our infirmities. We know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself, really a bad translation, the Spirit himself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Huh? And verse 27, the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the will of God. Hey, that's pretty advanced Christianity, isn't it? Huh? We know not what to pray. Oh, we know how to give God a shopping list. We know how to tell God, do this, that, that. Oh, the pastor said, remember to pray for the building fund. The devil doesn't care if you build a church from here to Miami. That won't worry him. But somehow if we can get people so desiring the anointing of God that they'd rather pray with groanings and tears and sing like Galli Curci or have a better voice than Richard Tucker had in the opera in New York. Now I've heard people say when it says that we pray with groanings, it's like praying in tongues. It's nothing of the kind. Because if it was, God would say so. It's beyond that. The greatest language of prayer has no vocabulary. The greatest prayers in the Bible have no words. Friday night, I think I'm going to talk on Hannah. Do you remember Hannah, how she prayed? And even the man of God thought, the priest thought she was drunk. And she groaned and she trembled. She was barren. I suggest to you, with all the little pretty little conferences we have going on now about the Holy Spirit and all the rest, we're a barren people before God. We have no revival in the land. But I'll tell you this, when the Holy Ghost comes and begins to burden people, it's a pretty, pretty rough thing to learn the true language of intercession. But the Spirit helpeth our infirmities. Let's come to this verse right here for a minute or two. In all these things, he's mentioned them. Sort them out when you go home, will you? Tribulation, distress, famine, peril, nakedness, sword, perils of the deep, so forth, so on. Sort them out. Put them in little sections like that. And you'll find that some of them are things that attack the body, some attack the mind, some attack the spirit. And he says, in all these things, there is no area in your life where, as a Christian, you're expected to be defeated. You say, I can't be perfect, can't you? Are you sure? Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, be ye therefore perfect. He said of Job, hast thou, to the devil, hast thou considered my servant Job? He's perfect and upright. He set a task for Abraham before the Holy Ghost was given, as we know. And he said, walk before me and be thou perfect. You can't have Adamic perfection in your body. You can't have mental perfection. There are many areas you can't have perfection, but you can have perfect obedience. One pastor got desperate. He said, my people come to church, pay their tithes, routine, they've no passion, no vision, they're worldly. They enjoy bowling a lot more than groaning. They like fishing for tiddlers in the water much more than fishing for men. No more of them are traveling than travailing. And he said to his wife and another man and woman in the church, can we agree together that God will send us revival? And they did. They prayed. Oh my. Sometimes it's very painful. When, in fact, I don't know whether God ever does any blessing without painfulness. If he could have done it without painfulness, he'd have done it for his son. But his son had to go through the horrors of Gethsemane and the cross. So this preacher and his wife and the other man and his wife, she played the organ, I think, prayed. And God began to move them nearly all out of the church. From about 450 people, they went down to about 45, and they thought, well, now, Lord, Lord, put the brake on here. It's going to stop here, isn't it? The Lord said, no, you aren't here. And they went down until they were a very select company. The preacher and his wife, the oldest deacon and the organist, four of them. And instead of shutting the shop up, he said, keep on praying. Great, God's moving. Well, he sure was. They never asked him to move that way, but after all, you tell God to move, he does it. And he said, for weeks I preached to four people. And then he said, God began to turn the tide. And they started coming back, people got saved, and now he said he had hundreds of people. In another community, they heard about this and thought, my, that's great. Let's ask God to work. You see, the Holy Spirit is so wonderful. As I said last night, he's the Spirit of truth and he convicts of error. He's the Spirit of life, he convicts of death. He's the Spirit of power, he convicts of weakness. He's the Spirit of joy and he convicts of sorrow. And he's the Spirit of love. God hasn't raised you up to be a bottle-fed baby from here to eternity. He's coming to get his dues out of your life. He's invested a lot in you. He didn't save you that you might escape eternal fire. That's a fringe benefit. He saved you that you might be conformed to the image of his Son. And however costly that may be, if you'll obey God, oh, you may escape now, but brother, he'll get you before long anyhow. The trouble in the Church of God today is we preach half a salvation. We tell people how to get rid of a lot of lousy sins. We don't tell them how to get rid of a prince inside that has dominion over them. What does he say? He says, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Well, tell me tonight, can Buddha do it? Can Confucius do it? Can transcendental meditation do it? No, sir, a thousand times over. There is one who is able to do it. Ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Come on tonight, are you in the spirit or in the flesh? Have you got secret lust? What's biting you on the inside? An unforgiving spirit, a grudge, laziness, jealousy, anger, secret lust? What is it? He says, ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be, now listen, the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Look at the next verse, verse 10, if Christ be in you. Look at the 11th verse, the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus dwell in you. Man alive, how in God's name can you be indwelt by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost to be defeated? Don't argue with me about it. Scratch it out of your Bible if you don't believe it. If you're a Christian, you're an indwelt person. God dwells in you. The Father dwells in you. That's what it says. I didn't write that, did I? I write good books. But they're not as good as this. The Holy Ghost wrote it. And he says, I want you to know that if you're really born of God, God dwells in you. One of the favorite hymns in my church is Beneath the Cross of Jesus. I think I weep every week when we sing it. It's a beautiful hymn. One phrase in it always gets to me. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of thy face. Dr. Tozer used to say to me, Len, you know, Christians don't tell lies, you just sing them. Is it true you ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face? A phrase that rips me every time I sing it, content to let the world go by. You've let it go by today. Did you ever try and jolt somebody before they slip into hell? Has it caused you any agonizing tears? Come on, you may be the one key holding up revival. Maybe just you, nobody else, I don't know.